All good, Father?
Start us up.
All right. That was incredible, Steve. I don't know if Steve's around, but brother, that, I mean, I said this last night after, Trevor spoke. No, that was that last night? No, well, it was Dr. Wood and Father Burke. After they had spoken last night, I was just like, man, like, we can all check, please. Well, here's our keys. Let's just go home. Like, I'm ready to be the man and the father and the husband that God's called me to be. And then hearing Trevor speak this morning and Mass with Father Pedro, I mean, and then Steve, I mean, gosh, your heart, brother, just absolutely beautiful. So thank you. Thank you. So in baseball, typically the pitchers are known as non-athletes, right? when we played, Trevor Williams always said, what are the pitchers supposed to be good at? Throwing strikes, fielding position, holding runners on, and golf, right? And bunting. And, we always joked as ball players, as athletes, you know, we'd get to the ballpark about 6, we'd lift weights, we'd go watch video, be on the work line at 9 for a stretch, and then we start playing catch about 9:30. Batting practice starts at 10. Right as we're starting our day, and we still have batting practice and then some conditioning, and then we have a game to play at 1, and then we get done at 4, maybe do some stuff in the trainer's room, we get home about 6. But as we're getting ready to, you know, crack that first swing in batting practice, we see all the kickers, the non-athletes, the pitchers, they're leaving. They're all wearing golf shorts and golf shirts, and they're off to go play. And so I always gave them the endearing term for pitchers, the way I described them. I said, you guys are one-dimensional athletes. You guys can throw a baseball, and you do a real good job at it, but you're like kickers in football. You know, like, I was good friends with a linebacker and a fullback for the Kansas City Chiefs, and he said, you know, our kickers, we'd be out there practicing all day, and the kickers would do this. They do that 7 times, and they're done for the day. So I gave our pitching staff the endearing term kickers. So, you guys are one-dimensional athletes, like kickers, and Jeff Supon was a great teammate, but he hated it. He hated when I called him non-athletes. He hated, hey, all the pitchers, you guys come over here. We're going to talk about bunt defense. And, hey, kickers, come on over here with the athletes. We're ready for you. So, but with all that being said, Jeff Supon in postseason history has more home runs than me. He set the home run record at Kresge High School. And he's a phenomenal athlete. I've never said this publicly, but Jeff, please forgive me for calling you a kicker because you're an incredible athlete. But today, I want to introduce you, my dear friend, my brother, my teammate, one we used to go to Mass with when we played, and is entitled his talk, The Bunt is in Order, Mr. Jeff Supon.
Still gets me. I'm not saying it's not true. All right. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Amen. Jesus, you promised us that where 2 or 3 are gathered in your name, you are here in our midst. And anything we agree upon and ask you, Heavenly Father, he will do. We thank you for your presence, for your grace, and your mercy. We ask you surround us with your angels and protect us with your precious blood. We ask that you anoint me with your Holy Spirit to guide me, to open all the ears of those who hear your word, Lord. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right.
That is a true statement, by the way. And man. The hair on my neck used to stand up. One of my favorite athletes of all time is a guy by the name of Steve Prefontaine. And I just read about him, I've watched the movie, and I don't know, he just really was inspiring to me. And one of his quotes was, to give anything less than your best is to sacrifice the gift. So I love that quote. And when I would think about that quote, okay, I was given a gift, if I don't give
if I don't give the best of what I can give, then I'm sacrificing what God has given me. And when I was getting close to retirement, we sold our house in Milwaukee. It was a really nice house. I told you about it, Bob. And we sold our house in Granada Hills, and we bought a new house. And we had this pool house. And so I'm like, man, I'm going to have my first real gym, you know? And so my trainer, Kathy, she said, I said, you know, Kathy, I can't, you know, it's the end of my career. I'm getting the gym I've always wanted. She goes, yeah, but you're going to need it now more than ever. And she's really right. But so she was, Kathy and I worked out for 15 years together. And so she's like, I had this great idea. My daughter and I, we're doing this stuff on the wall, and you could do it, you could put a quote up there, or like a saying. I said, oh my gosh. To give anything less than your best is to sacrifice the gift, and we're going to put it up on the wall. So she's like, all right, well, text it to me. So I was going to tell everyone here who has more than two kids, okay, now you have six, and you have, you got six, five in here, okay, listen, make sure you don't help the baby out in the family, okay? My mom, she gave me this prayer that I shared with you. She passed away about 9 years ago. She helped me out all the time. My dad did the same thing. So they spelled everything for me. I never had to look anything up in the dictionary. Like, freshman, make sure you look it up. So every day, and I never even noticed this, but every day when I walk in to my weight room, and I should say, every year when I walk in, it says, to give anything less than your best is to sacrifice. S-A-C-R-A-F-I-C-E. I spelled it wrong.
I spelled it wrong for crying out loud. In baseball, so what is a sacrifice? Okay, so this is, we all talked about this and panic was starting to set in because I thought we were going to all have the same little talk, and we kind of do, but, you know, the truth is the truth, right? So what is the sacrifice? The sacrifice is when a hitter is sacrificing his at-bat or an out to move a runner over. So you're basically moving a runner from first to second, from second to third, or both runners, first and second to second and third. That's what a sacrifice is, okay? And I actually had to look this one up, okay? Because I've always heard, there's always sayings that you hear, and they actually motivate me to find out what they are. But I heard this my whole life. Hey, bunts in order. I'm like, oh, whatever. Okay, I guess we got a bunt play on. Okay, I got third base. I got straight in, right? So, but the bunts in order. So I looked it up. So it's funny. So it says sacrifices are usually called when there's nobody out. Okay, I kind of get that, right? When a runner's on first or second or first and second, okay? And they're moving them over. Now, this is I want you to hear this. I thought this was hilarious. On a rare occasion, you'll see a sacrifice bunt with one out to move the runner from first to second. This usually happens in the major leagues, in the National League, when a pitcher is batting who is a very bad hitter. This is on the internet. What are they talking about? Okay, how many at-bats do you get a game?
Three.
Two.
Okay. How many starts do we have on average?
35.
We get 60 at-bats a year. How can you be good at anything if you only get 60 at-bats?
Okay, but Trevor was right. Keep the ball down, change speeds, work fast. That's the pitching part of it. You better be able to field your position, and you better be able to bunt, okay, if you're in the National League. If you're in the American League, you better be able to hold runners. When do the bunts happen? I never paid attention. Okay, but the bunt was in order. Okay, bunt's in order. Just give me the sign. I'll listen to my manager. Okay, but in a normal situation, if there's not a pitcher, it's going to usually happen later in the game. All right, earlier in the game, you play for more runs. Right, so later in the game, you're going to play for the one run. But for pitchers, we just bunt it. I mean, so I love the sign though. I'm not telling anybody. But my sign used to be the nose, right? And so Jose Oquendo was our third base coach. Spanish guy, right? So I used to joke around. I thought I was saying it correctly, but instead of saying Feliz Navidad, I used to say Nariz Navidad. Nariz Navidad. So Nariz is nose, right? So he said, what do you want your bunt sign to be? I said, not ETH, you know? And so we had, I tell you, we had some great bonds. Now, Tony took it to the next level. So he had like this situation where you were bunting, okay? And then we would draw back, right? And then we would bunt again, right? So I hope he never heard me, but I'd be like, I'm bunting. No, I'm not. Yes, I am.
But it worked. It worked. It changed the defense. All right? Now, the squeeze bunt, okay? The squeeze bunt, or they call it the suicide squeeze, right? So this is where the runner is going to leave early when the pitcher starts his motion. And it's like you're selling out for the one run. That's what you're doing. It's the squeeze bunt. They also have a safety squeeze, but you got to have speed. I was never a part of that one. Okay? Never a part of that one. So, my bunting career. Okay? I mean, let's face it. Are there ever any highlights of people bunting?
No.
Have you ever seen a sacrifice bunt as a highlight?
No.
I coach with a guy. He's awesome. His name is Coach Rick. It's girls softball, of course. And he always says, Sports Center, they make a great play. Sports Center. But there's no Sports Center for the average. There's no Sports Center for the routine. There's no Sports Center for the great sack bunt down. No, they want to see the home run, right? They want to see the great play, right? Sween mentioned it, and as many of you in here already know, I do have the home run record at Crespi Carmelite High School. Okay? You guys haven't played him yet, but you will, okay? I know you guys, Jay Sierra, you guys are big time. You got a big time feel, you know? But many of you don't know that I struggled in my first six games in high school for hitting, right? And pitching a little bit. And so my brother Dan, I'm the youngest of five, so my brother Dan, he was always like my biggest supporter, right? And so he actually said, hey, bro, call each other bro. Hey, bro, listen, I'm going to give you $20 for every home run you hit. Okay? So I'm like, all right. So I start going around the ball, and I started, you know, taking the knob of the ball, finishing, you know, lift and separate, light tower power. And so 11 home runs I hit.
Light tower power.
Okay, 11 home runs in the next 24 games I hit. Okay, so I brought my focus in, and my brother helped me realize that the biggest thing was that I really was a professional player. Okay, I needed to get paid to perform. That's what I need. So I'm drafted that year, and I go to the American League. I don't hit for 5 years, you know. And in the American League, Sweeney is correct that we are primarily kickers. Okay, but I didn't hit at all, right? So I go to the National League. I'm taken in the expansion draft in 1998 by the Arizona Diamondbacks, and Buck Showalter is our manager. And so he said to us, listen, if you can't bunt, you will not get another at-bat. You're not going to get your second at-bat, okay? If you can't bunt, you are out of the game. Okay, so I'm going to make sure I know how to bunt, right? So my first day of BP, we're not even bunting, we're just hitting, and so I'm taking swings, boom, top of the cage. I used to hit in high school, boom. I had 11 bombs. So Big Bean, or Andy Bennett says, he has his name, we call him Big Bean. He says, Soup, you play golf? Of course I play golf. He's like, you ever top ball? I said, yeah. He goes, why? Because I'm looking up. He goes, right, it's just like hitting. Don't look up. Okay, you're trying to watch the ball when you hit, right? So I'm like, and you saw the natural, right? You know, when he had the little thing and take that BP, and that was kind of like me. I like, keep my eye on the ball, and so I'm not hitting the ball.
Just kidding, but I'm hitting the ball.
That's the key. Now, the one thing that Buck Showalter didn't tell me is that if you don't pitch well, you're not in the game. So I did hit pretty well. I think I hit like maybe 280, 300 in the short at bats I had. But But I was 1-7 with the 7 ERA. So I was out of the game anyway. But that year I did get the opportunity to go to Kansas City and play with Sweeney because I was so bad. They got rid of me. And I did give up 2 home runs to Mark McGwire when he hit 70. And I have a jersey in my office that says, "To Soup, thanks for 5-6. Those are some positives, right? So I sacrificed a really bad year, but had some positives. Go to Kansas City, and Tom Gamboa was one of our coaches. He actually had a great explanation for bunting. I mean, I just love the way he taught it, right? So I still use the Crespi way. As my feet are shoulder width apart, I lean forward till my toes grab, slight bend in my knees, hands right off the shoulder, right? And so what Gamby said was, now listen, when you bunt, okay, you always set your bat at the highest level of the strike zone. You never go up, okay? So if you go up or you jab at it, it sends the ball up or down, okay? So I said, all right, so I pivot, put my bat at the highest point of the strike zone, my hands behind it. You didn't have to wear those, but I used to have to wear those, the soft pad, right? So I didn't jam my finger. That used to really hurt. Or did you wear it? Highest point of the strike zone, right? And then you bump with your legs, right? You bump with your legs. This is how you bunt, right? Now, Gamby said, now listen, if you want to get really good, if you want to bunt it to first when there's a runner on first base, you take the knob and you point it to third base. Oh my gosh, that really makes sense to me. Oh, if you want to bunt it to third base, you point it at the first baseman. Oh my gosh, right? So I actually learned how to bunt. It was irrelevant now because I was in the American League again. But it really taught me to concentrate. I got comfortable. I just sold out. I was like, I don't care where the ball is, even though I'm afraid. I don't care where the ball is. I'm going to bunt it. Okay. So toughest bunt. Toughest pitcher to bunt off of was Randy Johnson. I had no idea where the ball was coming from. No idea. I was just bunting air. Okay? Now, when I was in Milwaukee, something happened with one of the hitters. And I was like the pinch bunter. Now, you know, being in a bullpen and the phone rings, you get this heart rate. Well, I didn't know that happened as the pinch hitter or pinch bunter, right? So I used to have relaxing days sitting on the bench watching the game. You know, eating seeds, flicking seeds, having all these different games going on. But now I have to pinch bunt, okay? And so my first pinch bunt is a national game. So he's like, hey, Soup, you know, this guy gets on, I'm like, all right, I had all my stuff. I am so nervous, okay? So, Soup, hey, you're going to bunt. If he gets on, you bunt. Put my book bag gloves on. I'm just bunting. Now I'm expected to bunt. Okay? I thought I was good for a pitcher, but now I have expectations, you know? And so it's Adam Wainwright. So I don't know if you do it this way or you do it this way or you did it this way, but if it was a starting pitcher, I'll give you a pitch to bunt. No problem. As long as you give me a pitch to bunt, dude. Okay? If you don't give me a pitch, if you pitch me inside, I'm coming hard in on you, okay? But I will give you a pitch to bunt. So my first bunt, National League game, nice and easy, Adam went, boom, go to jog. Nice and easy, jog first base, I'm out, move the runner over. I did my job, he got his out, and he got out of the inning. But it was easy, okay? And then, this is obviously a different game, I had to pinch bunt again. And it was ironically against the Cardinals again. It was Kyle McClellan or whatever. Super sinker. I mean, it was a super sinker. And I was like overconfident on my bunting skills. So I'm up there. I'm like, I got you. I had a bunt National League game. Sinker bunter. You know? And now relievers try to get you out. They try to strike you out, right? The starters, they don't, you know, I'll take a strikeout, but I'd rather just throw one pitch and get you out, right? So he throws this super sinker. Boom! Almost off my hand. Scared me to death. I couldn't bunt the rest of the year. Okay. Couldn't bunt the rest of the year. But kind of like sacrifices in themselves, some are easy and some are hard, okay? So I did have one squeeze bunt. We used to practice because there is the up and in and there is the throw outside. So I used to actually practice my squeeze bunt
And I asked, Dave McKay was our first base coach, and I asked, can you throw the bat? He's like, yeah. So I used to practice squaring late, and they were throwing outside, and I throw my bat, right? So, because you never know. And I had to get the money. So game seven, Roger Clemens, I hadn't beat him all year. It was an 0-4. And I get the squeeze sign. It was unbelievable. It was unbelievable. So I never saw a highlight of it. I don't even know where it is because it's just a squeeze bunt, right? Even though it's higher than a sacrifice bunt, they still don't care because what you see is Rollins' home run to win the game, right? They don't see the squeeze bunt. So whatever it is, I have no idea who's on third. I have no idea. I just know I get a squeeze bunt off the rocket. He pitches, I pitch, whoosh, and I get it down, and we get that run in. And I was so thankful because they don't happen that often. Okay, that's a pretty big time play that you don't really see highlights for. Okay, so the ultimate sacrifice. Okay, so the rupture between God and the human race was so big. Okay, it demanded a sacrifice. Right. Mm-hmm. So in the Old Testament, it's filled with a lot of those sacrifices. Or sin offerings. And they were all offered by man. The sheep, you know, the bloody sacrifice there. Yet none of these sacrifices could make us one or atone for that sin. Because this gap was infinite between man, the created, and God, the creator. But Jesus offers the bloody sacrifice of himself as man and as God. And so it makes us atoned with God. And using the idea of the game, the baseball game, and the sacrifice, so basically, we're all, humankind, is stranded at third base. Okay? And the human race has no way of making us home. Atonement, redemption. The distance is so great. The patriarchs, the prophets, the priests offered sacrifices, yet none of their sacrifices could get the runner home. As men, not the perfect hit, not the perfect choopy, bloop, bomb, squeeze, sack. Could close the gap between third and home. But now, the greatest hitter of all time, Jesus Christ, steps into the box. As true man and true God, and he offers the sacrifice of himself as man with the power of God. And this closes the gap between third and home and brings humanity home, atoned, at one with God. I mean, Jesus could have done it however he wanted to do it. I mean, he could have hit the bomb, you know? Could have had the Frank Thomas one-arm home run. I experienced that. but he didn't. He showed us how he wanted us to do it. Okay, because when we sacrifice, we are acting. We are like Christ. Okay, that idea of offering it up. Please pray for Father Dick. He's in Boston. He's an Opus Dei priest who was my first spiritual director. CRS, you know, I can't remember. And so he was struggling a little bit, and he's about 95 years old now. But he always used to say that to me, offer it up, offer it up. But it's true. And Dr. John, we talked about it. This might be your time to shine again, okay? We talked about it because I really loved last night how he talked about the sacrifice, okay, of bringing our sacrifices to the altar.
It's God allowing us to participate in salvation history. Can I steal your analogy? So that's a great analogy. How many kids do you have?
Four with one on the way.
Four with one? That's amazing. Remember, don't teach him everything. Don't let him, make sure he's a good speller. But he gave me the analogy of the dishes and helping, allowing your child to do the dishes. Because you know your system, right? If you're a good dishwasher guy, I am. You have your system. And it works quick. Boom. You grab all your forks. Boom. Here, you got your thumbs. You got your spots. You leave all the cabinets open. Your wife comes in. She yells at you for leaving all the cabinets open. You say, this is a part of the system. Okay. And you put it away. Okay. Now, you, as a good father, want to teach your son or your daughter how to do this. And it takes time. But you allow them to practice. This is going to help them in the future. This is the same way? Is that kind of close? Sacrifice is always hard. And Father Burke yesterday, in his great talk, he talked about several ways we can sacrifice. And the sacrifice brings out the best in us, okay? Especially when we do it out of love. When we are dying to ourselves, we are becoming more fully alive. That idea of the gap between third and home and what Jesus did on the cross for us is really is incredible. It's an incredible thing to try to understand or to grasp it. And we are called, all right, to be more fully alive. And I just want to thank you guys for listening to a few of my stories. I just think this is a wonderful retreat, and I appreciate every one of you being here and allowing me to be here, and I guess that's it. All right, listen, don't tell anybody about, okay? Okay, don't tell anybody about that, okay? That's a secret. Make sure you guys, okay? I want to see some good sack bunts out of you. Thank you.
Man, great job, Soup. Amazing. Amazing.